going to start by introducing ourselves through building a network. And what we're going to do is this wall here is going to be our tool. If I can ask everyone to stand, and what we're going to do is wrap the wall around your hand once you receive it. This is a vent session. So what we really want to understand is a bit about your frustrations, either from the policy end or from the science end, when it comes to communicating. So what are the things that you find difficult, or the things that you know you find really frustrating and you find, you know, you would love to be able to do better? Especially around communication and engagement. So this is the point where we're allowed to, you know, moan a little bit and say, this doesn't make me happy, this frustrates me. And it will be really good if we can listen to each other's frustrations and see what we could be doing in terms of communication to try and bridge some of those gaps. So I'll stand up if we can all stand. You might have to pull the string off the ball. The ball has had, you know, a bit of a bashing. Yes. This is the fourth session. So, you know, you might have to pull it apart a little. So I would start and say, my name is Nyasha, and I work as a communication person. And what I find really frustrating is that researchers and policymakers seem to be desiring the same things. They seem to ultimately want the same end. However, somewhere in between there seems to be a breakdown, and you know, I feel it could be resolved just by some dialogue, you know, policymakers being a little bit more open to sitting down around a table and hashing things out, and scientists also letting go a little bit of the science and, you know, wanting to simplify life for other people. So for me, that's a bit of a frustration because I feel we sometimes go around in circles. Oh, this is also about hand-eye coordination. Apparently communication has a lot to do with that. So let me see, who will I try and throw that to? There we go.
Okay. So, yeah, good morning to everyone. In Georgia, I'm working here at the GRC as a scientist in solar energy field. I was already before of this meeting frustrated because of my time constraints. You know, we have to speak about my job with the people. The time is always a very, very important factor, which is very, very difficult for me to take into account. Okay, here we go.
So I'm Davy. I'm also a scientist, also working at the GRC in the water resource unit. I have a bit the same frustration, maybe in the sense that, in my opinion, politicians don't always make decisions based on scientific evidence, even if the evidence is very clear. So that's maybe my biggest frustration at the end of the pipe. Okay.
I'm Leoka Diasho from South Africa. What is frustrating to me is like this lack of consistency. You hold this meeting today, tomorrow there's another audience. So you remain stagnant, you won't move. So sometimes it frustrates on what to make a decision. Thank you.
Thanks. My name is Patricia. I live in Amsterdam. I work in The Hague at the Rathenau Institute. The Rathenau Institute is meant to do assessments of science and technology developments and to share them with policymakers. And what frustrates me most is the sense I've got after I've given a talk. And I think I presented my message quite clearly. And then afterwards, people have heard quite different things than what I think I've told. That frustrates me. Is it clear?
Yeah.
That's usually the challenge now.
And there you go.
I'm Justina. I'm from Ghana. I work with the Policy Research Institute. So basically, our mandate is to conduct science and technology policy research and do policy reviews. My frustration is first from the academic community. I mean, our promotion is not based on how much we influence policy or how much our research is being uptake by industry or policy. So we end up trying to impress, write papers, get published. But we don't really, I mean, it's not really a problem if they take our policies or not. And from the policy side too, the major issue is that they are also driving their own political agenda. So sometimes we try to contribute to their process and then it doesn't meet their manifesto or whatever. So it's a bit of a challenge. We are all trying to converge at a point, but I think there should be some bit of synergy at a point. So that's my biggest frustration.
Oops. Thank you. So my name is Aleš. Good morning to everyone. I'm employed at the Slovenian Water Agency, and my main frustration is that sometimes I feel and I act and I work as a scientist and sometimes as a policymaker. So when I'm feeling like a scientist, I do feel the time pressure and I do feel the problem that decisions are made without clear evidence. When I work as a policymaker, I'm again frustrated because I know that I do not have time to wait for the evidence, mainly what we are talking about these days. So,
keep one of the.
Okay.
Oh, yes.
Otherwise, you're not good.
Okay,
so who is it? Who did you aim for?
Yes. No?
Decision made.
Yes.
Okay, my name is Lindy. I'm from the Kingdom of Swaziland. I work for the Department of Energy and I'm a coordinator of the Sustainable Energy for All initiative. I share the same frustrations as you. I'm at the bridge between being a scientist and a policymaker. And that causes a big frustration because policy. Yes, I think I tend to say that policymakers, as much as we're here as policymakers, but there's a level above us that we have no control over. And that's what frustrates me the most, being part scientist and part policymaker, because they make the wrong decisions. We do inform them. They make their own decisions. Like Justina said, they have their own agenda part of most of the time. So you are also accused of as being part of the problem when things go wrong, because you are supposed to, people feel you didn't advise the politicians properly, but you know very well that you did your job and they just didn't want to listen to the scientific evidence. And then when things go wrong, it comes back to us to fix it when you knew it was going to go wrong in the first place. So that causes, it makes the job very frustrating. Yeah.
Okay, let me do something.
Oh.
Hi. Good morning, everybody. I'm Valentina. I'm working for the National Institute for Economic Agriculture in Italy and for the Rural Network. So I'm a scientist, but I'm in the middle between like scientific research and policymakers.
Mm-hmm.
So I'm really frustrated when I think that most of the policymakers, they use our research as a puzzle. They just keep from this puzzle what they need and they build a new puzzle that maybe is not our base evidence, it's not our results.
Mm-hmm.
And sometimes that's just like maybe you are the one that I'm just trying to be clear with good results, and they choose just what they want. In the other, talking from the part of policymakers, I think researchers have a big problem of communication between them. So most of the time what's happening in Italy, but I think everywhere, there is no collaboration between researchers. So that's make me really angry. So I think this is a big problem that we need to solve.
Okay. Hi, my name is Simona. I live and work in Italy in the education sector. I'm mostly frustrated with the way policy making in my country, but also in Europe and generally, seems not to be able to deliver the correct message to the beneficiaries of policies. Because once you try to engage effectively the audience, the targets of your policies, you should be able to explain them why you're taking that set of decisions. which doesn't always happen. So
sorry, you can't be the last.
Your aim is very bad.
So, Evelyn Nambirumwara, I'm from the African Academy of Science, which is based in Nairobi. We are a pan-African organization that tries to bridge the gap between scientists and policymakers. So in a way, I'm also not a scientist, I'm not a policymaker. I have a science background, I also have a policymaking background. So I understand the frustrations that people are in that space face. One of my, I think, most frustrating issue I find is the fact that we, in many countries, I won't even say Africa, in many countries we have policymakers that are politically selected for votes and therefore are incompetent, especially in the fields that they are leading. And so is unable to really put together this information. As much as we have departments within the ministry, even when they communicate, I believe policymakers should be highly qualified for that field to input their experience, their knowledge, other than what they are being told. And because of that, they tend to make the wrong policies. Another frustration is, I think, this inability for scientists to work together. They work in silos, which means that many are actually doing things that someone else did maybe 10 years ago. There's no communication between them. And even when they come in, then they boast to be specialists. And they use this jargon in the communication. Very frustrating, you know. They need to be able to put that information, even if it's on nuclear science, in a way that other people can understand. So, are you ready?
Good morning. I'm Maurizio Sayeva. And I work for Natural Resources Institute, Luke, in Finland. I believe that they should be able also to communicate a message that is understandable from everybody. Because as we were in school, sometimes we didn't understand the professor. But sometimes it was the professor that he was not trying to make his best to be understood. So concepts, even if complex, can be simplified, yeah, can be explained in a nice way.
My frustration is the... can I have two frustrations and I'll be quick? One frustration is the lack of will to compromise from both sides, like wanting to go to meet the other person in the middle and not expect the other one to move completely 100%. And the other thing is the obsession with the technical knowledge and skills that policymakers need and not really getting the soft side of thing of what's going on within the institutions these people work in and the struggles and that they face and kind of getting that a little bit better in order to engage in a more effective way.
Okay.
Right.
Fabulous. So, now that we've complained and we've got all these things out and we know that there are no quick solutions, I want you to tug, you know, just get some tension and tug at your piece of the string. You know, tug it, you know, it's not gonna break, just pull. Can you feel tension coming from somewhere? Yes?
Yes.
This is what it's like when we try to navigate between the evidence and policy interface. This is the web. And somewhere in here lies strategic communication, which should allow us to try and find ways to
navigate
but also to be aware, right? That the complexities are many, and what are the best ways in which we can engage. So this is the network that we have to work through. So communication is about a host of tactics and tools that might help us to navigate this tension. But no matter what we do, we must be aware that, you know, no one intervention will allow us to get where we need to get because things remain complicated. So I just want us to be aware that in this session, we can do a little bit about communication, but communication is such a soft skill that requires us to constantly be refining it, constantly be innovating, to try and weave through all these tensions. So every time you get frustrated, remember that all these tensions are existing within our system. So with that, we can let go of the string and move on to our first activity. So thank you for humoring us and creating this intricate web.
Just drop it, it's fine.
So as we've agreed, you know, the policy and evidence base is really, it's really a complicated place with many actors. So what is it that we can do, you know, as researchers and as policymakers in terms of communicating well that will allow us to engage more systematically? And some of the things I was hearing is that, you know, there are loads of meetings, no one uses evidence, there are mixed messages, you know, there's need to synthesize information, things are very bureaucratic, there are political appointments, so all these are frustrations that in some ways communication can help us to overcome. And in this session, what we're going to do is we are going to practice a little bit on oral communication and a little bit on written communication. So what I'd like us to do is to speed date. Has anyone ever been on a speed date? Oh, fantastic. You're the first person to actually say you have been. Yes, okay, great. So we have some experience. Maybe you're more familiar with elevator pitches. What we're going to do is we're going to have 60 seconds. We're going to divide the room in two. We will have five policymakers and five researchers. So who are the people who most strongly identify as policy actors?
We are using, I know the term is very generic and we use this tag policymaker and researcher, but it's just a way to simplify the environment you work in and the type of work that you do. So if you mainly work in a public body making decisions or informing decision makers, identify yourselves as a policymaker and otherwise researcher.
Our policymakers are going to be assigned a role. This role is either that of a donor, a local government official, a national government official, local NGO, an international NGO. At the back of this card that you will receive is some information about what it is you're looking to do and where your interests lie. So there's a description at the back that you can read to familiarize yourself with your role. The remaining participants will act as the researchers. The researchers, in this case, are all working in the water, energy, and food nexus. However, as a researcher, you have the flexibility to create your own story about what it is you're researching around. So you have some flexibility. What you're going to do is you have an opportunity to engage with each policy actor. On the screens over there, we'll see the characteristics of each of the policy actors. What your role is as the scientist is to try and pitch in a minute to get a second meeting. So you're at some sort of a conference, or maybe you're, you know, in a rush somewhere in a government building, and you've just bumped into one of these individuals. And what you're going to try and do is to, you know, you've read about them a little bit, you know that they're working on some things. You're going to try and pitch to get a second interview, a second meeting. So what you want out of this interaction is for them to say, that's really interesting, let me give you my business card and we can have a second meeting, or you know what, call me on Monday, I want to sit down with you and hear more. So that is your objective, to try and get a second meeting. Policymakers, if you can take with you, we're all going to line up against the back there, if you can take with you a piece of a notepad and write, firstly, how many of these people you would have given a second meeting. Right, so just take note, and why it was you would have given these individuals a second meeting. I'm going to be very strict on time. You have 60 seconds to make your pitch. The policymaker can ask one clarifying question. This can be a conversation, so the clarifying question can be asked in the middle of the pitch or at the end of the 60 seconds. I'll give you 15 more seconds if there's a question, and then you will all move on to your right. Not all, but all the researchers will move to their right and start to pitch to the next individual.
You'll have a bit of time in between to read the profile of the person you're going to be speaking to so that you can adapt your message.
If I can ask everyone to stand in front of someone. So stand in front of one policymaker. So what's going to happen is I am going to say start, and you will have 60 seconds to make your pitch to this policymaker, and the policymaker will get back, will not say any, you won't let them know if you're having a meeting yet. We'll discuss that after.
One for the experience, so the long experience on the sector. The other one because they are really they won't have a good impact at the diversity level, and in the other one because they think that it's really really important to involve social actors and stakeholders.
So they met your criteria.
Yeah.
Okay. The next policymaker.
Okay, I also chose three. And my reasons for choosing the three, yes, experience was important, but I was also very impressed. Some of them gave their approach immediately, how they'd go about doing it, how they'd assemble the teams. And one of them also went as far as talking about technology. So that was quite interesting. So it was almost like a full proposal in 60 seconds. I could already envisage what the person is bringing in.
What were you, sorry?
I was local NGO looking in.
Okay, yes. Right.
Oh my God. Okay. So I said yes to three people and no to two. No, because one did not introduce themselves properly. And they were not sure of what they wanted to do for me. They were asking me, what do you want me to do?
So it was hilarious.
When I said yes to three, for several reasons. One was actually very articulate, had examples.
Wow.
Even could give the years, the length of time they'd worked. I mean, they were passionate about what they were talking. So very impressive. And felt like they were going to help me with whatever problem I had. One actually pitched that they were local. So they would approach this from with an understanding of the local situation, which I thought was very good. And also they were charming.
Okay, charming.
Yeah, so just for that, I would have wanted to talk more about to them. Yes. Then, by the way, I'm married. Then the other one was very passionate about the idea. Even though I didn't know what they were proposing to do, I wanted to hear more about it. Yeah. So indeed, if you show passion, you can, I think, get something.
Can I ask a question?
Sure.
Are you going to have, actually, a second meeting with the people we have selected or not?
Unfortunately, today we can't do that. Okay. But what we're trying to do is just to pick up what kinds of things you need, what kind of skills you need when you've got limited time to impress somebody to do something for you. The national government official.
The three people I would not meet again, I did so for various reasons. One of them did not relate at all to my problems, but was only telling what this person was very skilled at. And I thought that was very interesting, but it had no relationship whatsoever with my concerns. The other one also was a very passionate researcher, was telling me very passionately about the research, but then I also could not see how that related to the problems I am having. Although it is a bit hesitant because the passion is fantastic and the person was very attractive. But then I still decided no, because what's the use? And the third person, I did not want to, because this person did not introduce himself to me properly. Properly. So then I don't know who I'm talking to. The persons I did decide to invite, I did so because one person related from the very first sentence very intensely to the things I am concerned about, and this person showed himself very familiar with my issues, and even with the country, the language I speak. So that's irresistible. And the other person, formulated exactly, in fact, what I was looking for.
Fantastic. The donor. I think that was our last question.
Yeah. My role was to care especially for the involvement of multiple stakeholders in the activities I am supposed to fund. Out of the five, I picked three. One, I would like to meet again, but in order to clarify issues, and two, obviously, also in order to clarify issues, but because they were locally based and they already had the kind of, you know, of feeling of understanding of the situation. So yeah, three, and also because they didn't try to sell a specific product, but because they had a vision, a strategy of involvement. Which could be adaptation or, you know, collaboration, but a strategy for something. In my specific case, I had to look for multiple stakeholders' engagement, so I wanted to hear about vision, strategy of involvement of multiple, exactly, communities, local NGOs, whatever, multiple partners, actors.
Great. So what I'm hearing a lot of, and what I know you already know, is that when we engage in oral communication, when we are communicating verbally, one of the key things is really understanding the needs of the person we are trying to get to do something. And I know you're thinking, well, it's not always possible, but, you know, coming to a conference like this, or maybe you're going to a meeting at the ministry, there's always things we can do to see who's participating. Usually their participant lists are distributed. You can check what's on their LinkedIn profiles. You can check what their websites say, and try to align your conversation to the things that would attract them to talking to you. And I know it sounds like tedious work, but actually that's the first step to getting your foot in the door. I'd like to ask the researchers briefly if there's anyone who has any reflections on this process. What were the key things you kind of took away, and, you know, are there any things that you would do differently just by thinking a little bit differently about how we engage with our stakeholders at this point? So you had the tough task of having to be the multiple actors. Are there any reflections?
Well, I think it was too short. I think in realistic life like this, I think it's not an issue. So short.
Really?
Well, maybe if you talk to very high level people, yes. But in general, 20 seconds for explaining something. You cannot explain something in 20 seconds, you know. Mm-hmm. I think if you talk,
that's a good point. If
a policymaker always has to talk in 20 seconds to somebody, I think he or she gets crazy.
Because no, that's people very just true. I think what we were trying to mimic is that your time is limited, especially with people who have, you know, busy schedules. So this was just, you know, a chance meeting. You meet this person and you're trying to get them to call you in for a second, you know, for a proper meeting where you can then go into the particulars and discuss, you know, what you're thinking. So the whole idea of an elevator pitch is that, imagine you were in an elevator and maybe you're on the 10th floor and you've only got that time from the 10th floor to the ground floor to get someone to, and these things do happen sometimes. Sometimes, you know, communication really is about being succinct, about being clear. So these are some of the things that other people in the sessions before thought were really useful. If you could just go to the next, you know.
Yeah,
so one of the lessons, you know, are about, you know, speaking, you know, messages that suit your audience, being clear, being purposeful, making a pitch and addressing the needs of that audience that you're trying to get a business card from or a meeting from. So sometimes we don't have the luxury of a conference where we can present our work. We only have a few minutes to make an impression. So how do we make it
how do we make it count?
The important things that also came up from the other sessions that I think is worth highlighting in such a short time that sometimes it's real, it's not all the time, but when it happens, looking at the other person's eyes, feeling confident, body language really adds value if you can kind of use your hands and smile and have a good attitude. What are the things that you said today? Showing a vision and passion that sometimes it's about, yesterday somebody said, intuition and a gut feeling. What you're trying to do there is get another meeting where you can then expand and show everything that you know and really get into a conversation. But sometimes it's just like getting that feel, that connection first. So in the half hour that we have left, we'll try to discuss a little bit policy briefs. Understand what their function is and how they are usually structured. But most importantly, try to compare and discuss the different type of information that policymakers and researchers value when they receive information. So who here has experience or are familiar with policy briefs in writing them or reading them in any way? Okay, we have a few that have some. In general, I see people nodding. So I'll just give a quick overview of what a policy brief is. So it's usually a summary of a specific issue. It can give options of different policies that can deal with it. And it usually also comes with a few recommendations of what to do about it. It's aimed at decision makers and people who maybe want to influence policy. Here I particularly say decision makers and not policy makers, because sometimes policy briefs can be aimed for people who need to make decisions but not necessarily involved in policy, and these products are useful as well. And it can take different formats. It can go from a one pager to four pages. It usually has a very attractive design. It has diagrams and graphs that can give a quick idea of what the topic is about and what the real problem is. So now we'll have a few minutes to do another exercise. And the idea is again to pair up with our colleague who is either a researcher or a policymaker. So we'll have one researcher and one policymaker sitting together. And I'll distribute a policy brief for each one of you. Maybe let's first start by pairing up. Could we use the people who are standing as policymakers pair with one of the researchers and just sit together? In terms of the messages and how the brief is structured and designed?
Most of our criteria were similar, but actually in one, like clear beginning and clear context analysis, we were in a context, maybe because I'm not from Africa, and the case study was in Africa, in Uganda. Yes. So actually she know even better than me the situation in the context analysis. And for me, the notion and it was enough just to understand maybe the situation. She say, no, this is partially.
Is there any other couple that would like to share?
But when you pick the title, you say adapting agriculture through local knowledge. So for me, as a scientist, it was a bit vague to me. But for her, she thinks, because she's come from policy, so she said it was a bit okay and then informative. So I think it's the way we look at it. Our lenses are a bit different.
Right.
Yeah.
We also, we were doing the exercise ourselves as well, and we picked up the same thing. Like, this is about climate change. Why in the title it says agriculture? So, it's subjective as well, the perception. Somebody else would like to share?
I had the impression that the evidence was not accurately presented, particularly.
The arms?
Yes. They particularly the references were not really, in my opinion, very concrete and very scientific and recognized. But instead, he said, I mean, probably from a, because this will probably go to a policymaker. A policymaker would be more interested, in this kind of information related to the project involved in this topic,
yes,
more than, you know, in reference to scientific publication.
Yes.
And I have to say that she was completely right. I mean,
yeah.
I misunderstood
yeah,
the format that I was supposed to have this kind of documents.
Yeah.
And the other part was still related to the visual presentation. I didn't like so much the colors of the text of the titles, probably too light, and also the format was not really up or not consistent.
Yeah,
and
just another thing, you know, you were talking about the need for evidence. What you can do, you know, this is always a problem we see where policymakers say, keep it simple, keep it short. I just want to know the main points. I want to know what you want me to do. If I read the first page, you know, then I should know exactly what it is I want to do. Whereas science says, where are the references, where's the context, how do we, you know, elaborate. What you can do is put a link, you know, so you can always say, recommended reading, or for access to the working paper, see this. And then that way you can cover yourself and know that it's supported by robust information, but also meet the policymakers' needs to have it a little bit short and succinct and easy to access. So, yeah.
I think that visually the document has to be written in a nice way,
mm-hmm,
because as much this might actually be more scientific than what we got. We got Africa Adapt, which is on climate change, and I feel that as a policymaker, as a person who doesn't want to read loads of information that is cramped together, this I would have found easier to understand, because it had summaries, the key recommendations are right on the top. So although this is only 2 pages, if I was a policymaker and I wanted to choose what to read, I would certainly go for the more pages.
In our brief, which is the one, Farmer Field Schools and Land and Water Management, there is a very short note about each new field school receives a grant.
Uh-huh.
So it's only the only thing about the money, about the costs of the whole idea, in
yeah,
two words only. So who pays? Who receives, and so on.
Yeah. So you think that should be highlighted?
Of
more?
Course.
Yes.
Of
okay.
course.
Yes.
Policy costs.
So in general, you will find 2 types of policy briefs. You can have an advocacy one, where that is really advocating to take one position. And I think it's the one on the farmers. It's like, this worked in several places. We need to scale it up and invest more. And then you'll have other types of policy briefs that are objective. What they do is a synthesis of the evidence base on a specific issue or problem, and they recommend a few options, but they don't advocate for anything. They let that decision for the policymaker. So those are 2 different types, and it depends on what you're trying to achieve, the one that you would use. And what do they do? How are these documents different from others? They first give a bit of background so the person who's reading it can understand the problem that is at hand. It gives a bit of urgency, like why do people need to act now? So having that sense of this is important and we need to act on it. Sometimes, as I said, it gives alternatives, and sometimes it gives evidence to support one alternative. And it stimulates decision. The idea is that after reading or having a discussion about a brief, somebody is feeling that there's something to be done about it. And at the end, I've included a bit of a structure. So it doesn't matter how long the policy brief is, if it's 1 pager or 4, here's a bit of guidance on how you can distribute the information. So the executive statement, which is at the very beginning, usually we write it at the very end of the brief, so you just summarize what you're trying to say. Then you follow with an introduction that is usually 10 or 15% of the information, not more than that. Methodology that probably scientists and researchers are keen to include how they actually got to that information, and they feel they need to back up themselves. However, policymakers are not very interested sometimes. So maybe add a line, and then you can always have a link to your full working paper where you describe all your methodology. That follows usually results or conclusions, and then implications or recommendations, which is the most important thing.
You can also include those at the beginning, like in this policy brief. So if somebody only looks at the first page, you can see what the implications and recommendations are. And to finalize the references and resources. So if you can include that, it also gives a bit of credibility if the person who you're talking to doesn't know you. So sometimes you have the luxury to know who this brief is going to go to, and you can adapt it to your audience. Sometimes, in most of the cases, it's for a general audience, and it's difficult to please everyone. So have these categories in mind, just to make sure that you're including all of them, and balance according to what you're trying to achieve. In the summary of the session, you have a list of resources that we have included. They are all freely available online, and you can download them. There's lots of stuff that can help you write briefs. There are videos, there are many things. So if you are interested in knowing more about it, then go through those. And then it's a matter of practice as well.